Okay, so let's get started. I'm going to talk about IPFS. I'm not an expert in the topic, but I think it's a really interesting technology and important to talk about. It's like beta level technology at the moment, so I don't think so many are using it, but I'm not sure. How many of you have heard about it before? A couple? Anyone using it actually for production stuff? No. So, who am I? Fredrik Rubensson is my name. I've been doing software development for more than 20 years, so I'm like an old guy. I live in Stockholm, in Sweden, beautiful city, and I work for this company, GrUSP Talents, and we're actually looking for more people, so if you're interested in that, you could come and talk with me afterwards. It's a really nice city to live in, but we don't have that good food as, you know, Italy, so maybe not so good, I don't know. So this is like an agenda, so I will try to give a quick overview of the topic first. And then we will talk a bit about how IPFS might be something better for the web in the future. And then we will dig a bit into how it actually works. And finally, a couple of use cases. So a thing that makes me like really sad is the state of the internet today. Since I've been working with this for a long time, I was around when it started, like in 94, I was browsing the web on Mosaic. And it was like with great hopes that we started out. Anyone can publish like anything on the web. It's a really nice thing. And it's a distributed thing, essentially. But nowadays, it's mostly like most content is on a couple of big players, like Twitter, Facebook, Medium, stuff like that. And it's not so easy to just, you know, put up your own server and publish some stuff. So I think that should change, actually. And we as developers are like key to that, because my mom and dad, my siblings, they don't care about this. We have to go and show them what to do here, I think. So that's maybe the reason I talk about IPFS, is that I think we need to do something better with the web in the future. So what is it? You might think that it stands for the Internet Protocol File System, right? But no, it's the interplanetary file system. Whoa. So this is actually not on the homepage anymore, because maybe they think it's a bit far out or something, I don't know. But you see directly from the name that the approach here is that we should have a file system that you can have both on the Earth and maybe on Mars or some other planet. So it should be really distributed and work anyway. So that's kind of a great vision, right? So this is the selling point from the homepage. What is it? So a peer-to-peer hypermedia protocol to make the web faster, safer, and more open. So key point here is that it's a hypermedia protocol. It's actually meant to replace HTTP and also to like live in coexistence with HTTP. And that is a thing that might actually make it work to be something new for the web, since it can live together with the HTTP. we have seen lots of technology that could replace HTTP over the years, but since they are something else, it's not so easy to just move the whole web to something new. So for it to work, we need to do it like gradually. Here is a more maybe objective description from Wikipedia. IPFS is a protocol and eponymous network designed to create a content-addressable peer-to-peer method of storing and sharing hypermedia in a distributed file system. So I guess the main point here is that it's content-addressable. That's a very important property. If you have some content on IPFS, it will always have the same name. So if you come back with that name, you will always get the same content back. And that's a very, very nice property of something on the internet. We will talk more about that later. Also, it's like a mashup of many other technologies. So it's been built on quite a few other things. So you can say that it stands on the shoulder of giants, like this guy here. So maybe the main thing is BitTorrents. Maybe you have downloaded stuff from the internet sometime with BitTorrents. So this is basically done in the same. Neil, not you, okay, but the rest of you. Okay, cool. So it's basically the same technology as BitTorrents for handling this peer-to-peer network. Also, Git is a great source of inspiration with the version, the directory structure, and also the hashing of the names based on the content. So that is basically the same principle in IPFS as in Git. Also, another technique that's been known for a while is distributed hash tables to be able to look up content from distributed places. So I guess that's also related to the torrent technology. That was the quick overview. So I hope you got some idea about what it's about. So now we look at two opportunity spaces, I call it, reasons for why this could be a good thing. I think there are actually quite a few of them, but I chose to mention two at this point because I can talk forever. And the first one is about centralization versus peer-to-peer. And the other one is about content, the volatility of content, that content changes over time on the internet today. So let's start with the first one. So HTTP, it's a bit funny though, because when the web started out, we thought that this thing with HTTP and the web is like a decentralized thing, right? But now it seems like it's more becoming a centralized thing, because all these players, commercial interests, they are in centralized places, right? So it could be decentralized, but it's really not. IPFS, on the other hand, is peer-to-peer by design. So you don't have to know anything about where the content comes from. As long as you have a name, you can go and get it. So features of centralization is like control is in one place. There's one player controlling the content. So you can't really affect that. And if it's a nice player, maybe it's good. If it's a bad player, maybe it's not so good. Maybe if the player gets bought by someone else, tough luck perhaps. So what we need in this setup with the old web is that we need to trust the sites we interact with, that they actually provide content that we like. Also, another thing is single point of failure. This might be maybe one of the more important things. I don't know if you use Bitbucket. Some of you maybe, yeah. My last client, we used it and it went down for like a couple of hours in January, I think, or February. And we couldn't push to production anymore because we were so reliant on Bitbucket to, you know, be able to put stuff in production. So it's kind of ridiculous. And when you think about Git being a distributed version control system, it's even more ironic, I think. So this is basically the difference. So in HTTP, you access data in one place. Of course, we have CDNs and the clustered servers and stuff, but from the usage perspective, it's like you go to a domain and you try to find the data there. While in IPFS, the data could be in several places. Anyone that wants to save this data for the future can store it on their IPFS node. And it's also like distributed in a torrent way, so it's like all over the place. So you can look at an IPFS, the IPFS whole thing, like something like this, that you have lots of nodes. So consider I want to download something. Maybe I'm over here and I want to download something from the other side of this network. It might take a while the first time, but then maybe my neighbor wants to download the same thing tomorrow. Then it will actually exist. Maybe spread out a bit, but the nodes pretty close to where I am. So it will be really fast to get it the second time. So that's really a nice benefit. And even if someone wants to, this data is kind of cool, we want to save it in this area of the network, then we can actually just put it on a node close to us and have it there like forever, actually. Then we have the second opportunity that I will mention today, and that's the problem with the content, that it changes over time. And where IPFS counters that with being like a permanent place to have content. So it changes. So you can't really trust if you have data in on a you access data in some place and then you could go back tomorrow. You have no idea if it's actually there or will it be the same. It can have moved somewhere else. It can disappear also. so that's not so good. So you see sometimes on Wikipedia, for example, when they want to refer to some web page, they say like it was retrieved this date. At this point in time, it was a good reference for something. But who knows today? It's very hard to tell. So how long is now actually on the internet with HTTP? No one can actually know for sure, because the same thing can provide you with completely different information from day to day. And this, I mean, if everyone was nice, you know, good people, it might not be a problem, I guess. But when we have like states that like to interfere with stuff and maybe put some alternative version of Wikipedia out there, not so good anymore. On IPFS though, if you have actually put something out there and have a name for it, that name will always point to the same content. And that's really a great property, because then you can trust this content to always be the same. If you have a reference to this content, it will be the same all the time. So never trust a hippie, maybe, or the other way around, I don't know. With HTTP, the content may be the same, different or gone, and with IPFS it will always be the same. I already said this, so let's move on. So we're like halfway through, and the time is good. Nice. So how does it really work? So anyone can run a node, and all the nodes together, you know, makes a big network of things. So when we start a node, we get these three ports opened up. It's one for the swarm, like interacting with other nodes and interchanging data. There's one for the API, that's like accessing functionality in IPFS. And then there's one for the gateway, actually getting to the content in the network. So I thought we were gonna start a node here, could be fun, right? Daemon is ready. And then there is a nice little GUI here. Get maybe? Okay, let's go back later. So now we have a node, then we can do stuff like nothing there. Did it not start properly? We'll see. Yeah, it's okay. Okay, let's try to add something to this thing. We'll just add a string now. We can add whatever you want. Binary data, you know, directories, whatever. Just a string instead this time. Call, and I'm using the command line client now. That will access the IPFS I'm running here. And you can do exactly the same thing in any client out there. So now we got the hash back, and this is actually the name of this content. Verona is nice. So we can use that name now to look up this thing. So it was not so impressive to get it from localhost, right? But maybe it's more impressive to get it from IPFS gateway out there somewhere. Aha, no network, that's why. Failure. Okay, I will try this a bit quick, otherwise we don't do it. Okay. Let's hope for the best. Okay, we go back later and look at this, see if it worked. So it's a distributed file system, and this is like similar picture I showed you before. So while HTTP goes like through a number of nodes like this, when you want to get something to a consumer, you have to go through like 20 things on the way, routers and stuff. IPFS does it in a different way, and the main point here is that the consumer doesn't actually need to know where the publisher lives. And there can be several publishers, and it can get one of them. And the data can be spread out already in different, you know, torrents, and it can get those. So that's actually nice. So consider, for example, in Turkey, they had some problem with the government taking down Wikipedia. That was a bit sad. But then someone could put up Wikipedia on IPFS, or several, and it would be very hard to take it down. So it's a nice thing. Okay, this doesn't work. You have to trust me, this is cool. It will get it from the gateway eventually, if the network works. And yeah, unique names, that's really cool, right? They are very long though, so anyone see a problem with this? It's not very easy for my dad to use this, right? But they've done some work also with connecting a domain name-like thing, and they call it IPNS. And the idea behind that is to actually be able to change names behind the name also if you want to. Because sometimes you want to have, you know, a specific name for reference and stuff, and sometimes you don't. Sometimes you want to be able to update the data, so it's kind of different use cases. Implementations, the server I was running now is written in Go. There's also an implementation in JavaScript, that's pretty cool, and they're trying to make a node that can run in the browser, and that's really awesome, I think. So then you can interact in the browser with the IPFS data. That would be really cool. It's not really done yet, but it's getting there, I think. And then there are clients in whatever language you normally use, maybe not all of them, but some of them at least. So let's look at a couple of use cases. Yeah, Wikipedia, I mentioned that before. That's pretty cool. They have actually took the whole Wikipedia and made a snapshot, a static snapshot of it, so you can access it over the network. You can see if that works. Yeah, it does. Maybe this other stuff also works now. No. So here is actually the entire Wikipedia. There's no search though, so it's a bit, you know, limiting perhaps. But if you go to something here, Vincent van Gogh, for example, just change it here if you want to go to something else. And also maybe I want to access this from my local instance. See what I'm doing. I can do that also, so that's pretty cool. And you see the Swedish flag also. It's very nice. Okay, it's thinking still. So sometimes it takes some time to get the, there it's done. Sometimes it takes some time to actually get the data from, you know, somewhere far away. Because the instance probably is in America somewhere, and it's supposed to go over this peer-to-peer network, and if it's far away, it takes some time. If it's closer, it's faster. So that's, I guess, natural. I also think the performance will improve over time. So go back here. So that's one thing, Wikipedia. Another thing is blockchain. So one thing with, for example, Ethereum is that you can have contracts in the blockchain, right? And then you want probably to store some reference to some data in the blockchain, and that costs gas or whatever it's called in Ethereum. So you want that to be as small as possible. So then a reference to IPFS is actually a cheap thing to do, and also it has the nice property that it will not change. It will never be different from what it was in the beginning. So that's really nice for contracts, I would say. Ethereum is actually working on something called the Swarm, I think. So it's a similar thing to IPFS. So that's also an interesting initiative. And then if you think about the case that we go off the grid, this is a map of the least developed countries in the world. So like Africa mostly, some in Asia. And I also found some data on the cost of broadband bandwidth in the world, and it's typically more expensive in these countries than it is here. So getting to the internet in a fast and nice manner is not so easy. But if you can have some IPFS nodes, perhaps locally, storing some data that's important, maybe they can get to it a bit faster. Also consider this map. This is a map of the most used operating systems. And as you can see, it's Android actually in Africa and some of Asia. And the rest, the blue, is Windows. So that's a bit sad, I guess. It's not the single country in the world that uses Linux the most. That's really sad. But Android, I mean, then you can also think that Android on a mobile phone, maybe not so fast, so having data closer by would be a good thing. Maybe also shaky connections to the outside world from some of these countries. And also, obviously, outer space. So in the future, maybe we'll have IPFS nodes running on, this is Europa, the moon, on one of the moons of Jupiter, so who knows? It's a pretty cool thing to think about, at least. So is this the future? I don't know. I think there are probably many initiatives that might come in the future. This is one attempt to do something better for the web. I like it a lot, but I guess time will see how this works out. So final notes. This sadness that one can feel about the internet sometimes, what can we do about it? Is there a way to happiness? I strongly believe that we as developers, we need to actually take charge of this matter and try to choose technology that is good for the future. We can actually affect this a lot. And we should try to do that as much as possible. Whether it's IPFS or something else, doesn't matter maybe. So that's my final thought on that. And okay, thank you so much. It was very nice talking to you.